Hey, this is DJ from DJSTRAINS on YouTube, and I'm with my friend Susie, and I'm so excited.
Yes,
Susie. We are at the Pennsylvania Railroad Museum out here in Strasburg, Pennsylvania, and my friend Susie was one of the first women engineers, and she's going to do a presentation about her life as an engineer, and she wrote a book, which I'm going to have a link to at the end of this video, and you guys are going to buy this book. It's a great book. I've read from cover to cover, and my name's mentioned, And the book not only is a great story of the railroad, but it's a better story of determination. You're going to learn a lot from this young lady. So say hi to everybody on YouTube.
Hello, YouTube. Thank you, DJ.
And we're going to go and watch her presentation. Thanks for watching. Don't forget, the end of this video will be the link to buy her book. Thanks.
I didn't know 40 years ago that I would one day become a historical figure in a railroad museum. This one here in Pennsylvania. Little did I know at age 25. I also didn't know that 2 years ago I would write a book about my life as a railroad engineer. Today I'd like to share a little bit about this book and how it all started. And I want to let you know that this is my very first ever presentation. I'm a little bit nervous, but seeing as I feel like I know all of you, I'll be able to get through it. So I'm going to read a little bit about my first chapter called The Distant Train Whistle. And it tells a little bit about how I grew up and how I got interested in the trains. It's 12:01 in the morning, July 4th, 1953. A baby girl is born, a real firecracker, me. My mom had no idea what kind of future her spunky little bundle of joy would create. We lived in the small town of Orchard Park, New York, south of Buffalo. The busy local railroad seemed to run trains all day and night. We heard them rumbling down the rails, blowing their whistles for road crossings. It became second nature for us who lived there. If we didn't hear them, we thought something was wrong. So at the very beginning stages of my life, I learned to recognize the sound of a distant train whistle. My mom later told stories about how I kicked my feet, clapped my hands, and smiled when trains ran by, blowing their whistles. Mom said with a smile that my first words were, "Mama choo choo." Thank you, Mom. Through the years, I heard trains and their lonesome whistles in the distance, and I learned to love that sound. It felt like a faraway voice calling to me. In 1958, my dad put my cousin Doug's Lionel train set around the Christmas tree when I was 5. We were all so excited. After all, the magical, warm, and happy time of year brought the whole family together. I would lay on my stomach and watch the train go around and around, colored lights from the tree reflecting on its every move. Sometimes the train stopped in front of me. I pointed my tiny finger in the cab window of the locomotive and said, "I'm going to be an engineer and blow the whistle." Everyone laughed. The years rolled on and I turned 7. My dad wanted to build a small train table in the basement. I was all for that and wanted to help. It was HO scale, my very first train set. But I think my dad really thought it belonged to him because he was in charge. He was the boss. He was the engineer. I think all dads know what I mean. It took a while, but after hammering thousands and thousands of tiny little nails into a piece of plywood, it was time to connect the transformer. That was Dad's job. My job was to place the train on the track. And then the moment of long anticipated joy. Dad pushed the transformer lever forward. And the light on the lonesome, on the locomotive came on, but the engine needed that first little push to get it started. And wow, that was awesome. Our very own railroad. I wore my grandfather's original conductor's hat. I loved my grandfather, and I loved that black hat with the gold band. He worked for the old Delaware, Lackawanna, and Western Railroad. My dad said, and he pointed his finger at me and said, "You got railroad blood in you, kid." I smiled and felt proud. I didn't know then that the little home railroad built by my father and me would remain with me the rest of my life. I'd like to share with you just a few stories about my adventurous railroad career. And this is my first day on the railroad, and this is how I was introduced to the GG1 locomotive. And I think you're going to love this little story. It was my first day on the railroad, and I was excited, but I was also very nervous. I made my way over to the Edgemore Yard office in Wilmington, Delaware, to meet with my senior engineer named J.W. I was told that J.W. was the John Wayne of the railroad. I was to work a 3-to-11 engine job, and I thought, wow, locomotive sounded like my kind of job. I arrived at the yard office ahead of time because I was always a believer in being on time. Dad taught me that. The engineer had not arrived yet, so I sat on the bench in front of the yard office and waited for my engineer to arrive. Things were kind of quiet except for the sound of locomotives. Engineer J.W. arrived, and oh boy, did he really look like John Wayne and just as big. He walked and talked like him too. The only thing missing was a cowboy hat and a six gun. J.W. took one look at me, all 4 feet, 11 and 3/4 inches, and said, "Are you Susie?" I looked up and I said, "Yes, sir." Then he smiled and said, "Why, you're as cute as a bug's ear." I guess that was Marylander talk for fun. He asked if I was ready to learn how to be an engineer. And I said, "Yes, sir." It seemed that he took to me right away because he began telling the guys, "Look at my new fireman." It seemed as though J.W. really enjoyed letting everyone know I would be training with him. He put me under his wing, and from that moment on, he called me precious. I heard that other railroaders respected J.W. as one hell of an engineer. I felt safe and eager to learn from the best. J.W. got his orders from the yard office and said, "Come on, precious, let's go." We walked out the back door to the engine house pit. Wow, locomotives everywhere humming. I could feel the ground vibrating under my feet and a strong odor of diesel fumes. My heart pounded and I felt right at home. I knew I was off to a good start. I felt comfortable. I tagged along behind J.W., who stood 6'4" and about 230 pounds, with me, 4'11" and 115 pounds. Sometimes J.W. stopped and waited for me to catch up. He looked out for my safety. We approached three huge, large-looking black engines. They were enormous. I never saw such an engine. I wasn't even sure about it. Then JW said, and I love this, "Precious, you are about to climb aboard the famous Class GG1 electric locomotive, the pride of the Pennsylvania Railroad." I had expected something different, as I grew up in diesel country. Now I worked in both diesel and electrified railroad territory, known as the Northeast Corridor. This stretch of railroad, of course, runs between Washington, D.C. and New York City. I looked above my head at the overhead 11,000-volt catenary system. I felt so uneasy around all that high voltage. I didn't like it at all. J.W. sensed my fear and discomfort, but he set me at ease and explained to me how to be safe. I soon learned to respect the electric engines and overhead catenary lines. We had to climb aboard the steel stirrup ladder into the engine cab compartment. When I stood beside the huge engine, the first stirrup was chest high. Okay, I lost my place. JW put his hands together and made a booster step for me. And up I went, JW right behind me. We entered the cab of the GG1, a really old engine and rough looking. JW began to talk me through everything so I would become comfortable and familiar with the engine. But all the time I thought, oh, please don't make me run it. I truly felt intimidated by this giant locomotive. JW got our orders from the train dispatcher to leave the yard and proceed to the main line. We were going to Philadelphia. I wanted to learn. I watched everything JW did and listened to everything he said. The key word here was listened. He was really something. We started to roll. This was getting exciting. We got more orders from the tower operator to enter the main line and proceed to Philadelphia. We rolled at about 50 miles per hour. Chills ran through me. The awesome sound of that powerful, huge steel locomotive impressed me, and so did JW. For the next 2 months, I remained on the job with JW, and I must say, I had a great and exhilarating learning experience. I will never forget the day the John Wayne of the railroad lost my place again. I will never forget the day the John Wayne of the railroad said to me, "Precious, put those books away. I'm going to teach you how to run a train by the seat of your pants." And by golly, he did just that. I was off to a good start, and I knew I would be okay. Oh, as a qualified engineer. Now, here's a good one. I pulled in October 2nd, 1979, I became a locomotive engineer and received my diploma. My very first call off the extra board was an ENES train out of Edgemore Yard to Enola near Harrisburg. That route considered going up Amtrak first, the main line, and then off at Perryville to the Port Road branch along the Susquehanna River. And guess what? My very first train was pulled by none other than Old Rivets, the 4800, which now sits out here in the yard. Let me tell you, I was nervous. It was my very first time handling my own train. And none other, it was a horrendous storm, a terrible, terrible, terrible storm that knocked out power. And when I got to the Port Road branch, guess what? The power, the signals were out. I had to revert back to the old rule book and use manual block signal system. Don't forget, I was on the 4800. It has a very small window to look out, and it was tough, and we had to move along very, very slowly. But it was a hair-raising run, but Old Rivets brought me safely to my destination. And I am very proud to know that that locomotive is sitting out here and one day will again be restored. As an engineer, it was my time to learn all about the seniority game. I got bumped off the freight service, out of freight service, and I decided to try my hand in passenger service. I bid on a job called the Night Owl Amtrak. I was pleased to get the job, and I would be working with a senior engineer named Tom Staley. Tom had some 30 years behind the throttle of passenger engines. I enjoyed working with Tom, and he took the time to teach me everything he knew. This is when I became familiar with the class engine E60, which sits out here in the yard, which Patrick says is on its way to being restored. And I want to be here to help polish up the controls. Okay. Many engineers experience hair-raising incidents in their careers. I had my share of them. Just to let you know, and I won't read them all because they're all in the book, is I felt very privileged as an engineer to run trains through the years. And I never forgot those exhilarating moments of glory, sometimes interrupted by unpredictable moments of sheer terror. Some of the chapters of the stories in my book are called The Day the Air Brakes Failed. That was on one of my passenger trains out of Washington to New York. And believe me, at 27 years old, I thought that night I was gonna die. Then another trip was the man on the track, my first suicide, north of Philadelphia. The car that hit the train, oh, this is a good one. It was a young woman and her three children. Now, I was coming across the grade crossing on the Delmarva secondary track at 40 miles an hour, and I saw the car coming, and it didn't seem like it was going to slow down. And as I come across the crossing, in my peripheral vision, I saw the car strike the second engine of the fuel tank of the second engine, and the hood of the car went flying up, and by that time I was around a curve and I lost sight of the wreck. But that's in the book. And then there's the race to the crossing, a pickup truck that went parallel for many miles on the Indian River branch, followed me like a lot of rail fans do. And little did I know that he was going to try to beat me to the road crossing. And that's in the book, if you want to know how that ended. Then there was the wonderful truck driver who was driving the tanker truck that straddled the crossing, and I had a very, very, very heavy coal train. Then my moment of paranoia crossing the C&D Canal. You're going to love that one too. But that's just a few of my experiences, and like I said, they're in the book, and I'm glad to be able to share them with you in that form. So after a 15-year railroad career concluded, my sister Bonnie, who's 2 years older than me, would have liked to have been here with me today by my side, but due to health problems, she was not able to. So at the end of my career, she dedicated this to me, and I'd like to share it with you, and I hope I can get through it. Rail Rider by Bonnie Gaglia. To Susie Gaglia, my sister, the locomotive engineer. For 15 years, you have been riding the rails. Conrail can be proud of you. Our family is proud of you. Most of all, I am proud of you. Accomplishment is a small word to describe all you have been through. Your job is difficult for a man. For a woman to be accepted and succeed is phenomenal. I know it wasn't easy. You studied hard, trained hard, worked hard. It was an uphill battle all the way. There was a mountain to climb, and you climbed it. There were bridges to burn, and you burned them. Blood, sweat, and tears, and that's a fact, no cliche. The dangers were many. I worried all the time. The hours must have seemed endless to you. Struggle and sacrifice were a reality. Through it all, you held your head high. Railroading was in your blood. You lust to ride the rails was all you could see. You looked beyond anything that got in your way. You persevered and you succeeded. Your dedication to your job and fellow workers was admirable. All who know you respect you. I know railroading will always be your first love. Your heart beats a little faster every time you climb on the engine. You feel the power. You are in command. You pull the load. Such great responsibility rests on your little shoulders. I've seen the love in your eyes and the smile on your face every time you are around a train. In spite of the toils, the rewards were many. No one can ever say you didn't give it your all. Every time I hear the whistle blow, I'll think of you. If there is a forever, we'll ride the rails of glory, gold to glory. You'll be my engineer and lead me safely home. I know you didn't quit. You chose to move on, to ride the rails in a different direction. Walk tall, little sister. You are one hell of an amazing lady. Thank you, Bonnie, for that. Now I'd like to give my acknowledgments, firstly to Patrick Morrison, your director, and a very good choice by all of you. I thank you, Pat, for having me here amongst my friends. And I'd like to give acknowledgement to Ellen Martin, who is not here, the curator, who with Patrick had brought me around the museum and let me jump on all my old retired friends, which delighted me. And a special thanks to Richard D. Spence, who was the president and CEO of Conrail at the time, and I just realized that this year he passed away at age 90. He was the one person that believed in me to give me a second chance. And the way everything came about and how I became an engineer is in letters, original letters that were written to the personnel that they kind of gave me the runaround, and I took all those letters and put them in one big package and sent them off to him. And I got results, and I didn't let him down. I'd like to give thanks to Reverend Douglas Drown, who is not here. He wrote one of the blurbs in the back of my book. And the residents of Applewood Loomis Communities, where I now work. And they, for years, have heard my story and kept telling me, you should write a book. You should write a book. So 2 years ago, I took pencil and paper and I wrote a book. Last but not least, I'd like to thank my very friend who made it here today, Dominic DJ Arlea, engineer, CSX, Baltimore Division. I think he got some 20, 21 years. And I thank DJ for being here, and I would love for him to just say a few words, if he would, before I introduced Chris. Thank you.
Yeah.
There's DJ.
Yeah. A couple years ago, I'm not going to raise this up even for me. A couple years ago, on my YouTube channel is how I met Susie. As an engineer, she sent me a message, hey, I was one of the first women engineers, and we became really good friends online. It's the first time we've ever met, and when you sent me your book, it was one of those things. I actually read the whole thing cover to cover. It took me 2 days. It's a very easy read. It's one of those books that once you start, you're like, okay, I'm already a few hours into this book. You don't want to put it down. And it's like addicting. You just keep reading. Okay, I'll just take a break after this chapter. So what I've noticed so much about the book is, besides all the great stories, especially for us rail fans, we love seeing the details in the stories. But I have a daughter, and I was telling her, this book is so much about perseverance. It's so many people just give up with their first rejection, but not Susie. And hearing all those, you know, reading the stories about how there was, things were way different back then, and the challenges that you faced, and you faced them tremendously, and it just shows determination that I haven't seen in many people. And I am so, so proud that, yeah, I drove 3.5 hours. I was not going to miss today. She is just a fabulous person, and I'm just glad God put her in my life. So another big round of applause. And the book is really good. Everyone should be walking out of here with one or two copies. They're great Christmas presents also, especially just for women in general. Just, you can do anything, and I mean anything. So another big round of applause for my friend Susie.
Give me that microphone back. I'd like to introduce, he's more than just a boyfriend. He's my best friend. He's my world. He's my whole life. 4 months ago, I had tremendous, I underwent surgery, and I had a long climb back, a good 10, 12 weeks of recovery, and I'm thankful to be here today. And I'm here today because of Chris. And Chris helped me put this presentation together because my mind was focused mainly on my health. So I'd like to thank Chris for all you've done. And I'd like to introduce you to Chris.
Thank you, Susie, Patrick. Nice to meet you, DJ, everybody. It's great to be back in Pennsylvania. This is the longest I've spent here since 1961, when I spent the first 10 months of my life in Pennsylvania, out in the western part of the state in Meadville. I first became acquainted with Susie last year during the final preparation of her book. Although I had a short volunteer career myself as a conductor and engineer on the 2-foot gauge Sand River Ranger Lakes Railroad Museum in Maine, I certainly can't hold a candle to anything Susie has done. And I'm not sure if she mentioned it or not, but there are 8 locomotives here in the Railroad Museum of Pennsylvania at Strasburg, which Susie ran and pulled trains with. That's really something.
My old friends.
Susie was one of the pioneer women who conquered the hardships and challenges of breaking into what was previously known as a man's world. And for that, I greatly admire her. Through her perseverance and the kindness of good mentors in the railroad industry, Susie fulfilled her dream of becoming a freight and passenger engineer in the 1970s along the Northeast Corridor, one of America's busiest railroads. Is Susie's railroad career all behind her? Perhaps not. This summer, 2 months ago yesterday in fact, we visited the Conway Scenic Railroad in New Hampshire's beautiful White Mountains. I introduced Susie to the railroad's new owner and president, who I've known for many years. Once he heard of Susie's career working for Conrail Amtrak, he invited her to come and run trains for them. One engineer up there just celebrated his 90th birthday, so perhaps a youngster like Susie may have a second career in museum train service.
Mm-hmm.